It's a real privilege to have another shot at the General Assembly, which you can tell is a really successful enterprise this time around because the coffee bar is filled up and people don't want to come back in. That's a sign of a good meeting. As an academic historian, I'm obviously much more at home and comfortable with trying to explain to you what happened when all the people are dead than trying to help living people put to use historical information, but I'm going to attempt to do that today, and hopefully that can be a stimulus in your own thinking to consider how you might, in your own churches, appropriately and helpfully commemorate the 500 years of Protestant history that we are experiencing this year. We need, however, to begin by recognizing the great differences between 2017 and earlier commemorations that also tried to remember the Reformation. Unfortunately, many of those earlier commemorations are lessons in how not to remember the Reformation. So in 1617, 100 years after the promulgation of the 95 Theses, in 1517, Calvinists criticized Lutherans for not extending the Reformation far enough. Lutherans responded by criticizing Calvinists for being picky, and Catholics set a plague on both your houses. Lutherans did something also that was very unfortunate. In 1617, they did a special collection of Martin Luther's works for that anniversary, and it was a collection of his writings on the Jews, which included that terrible tract from 1643 and others later in his life that were really very offensive. In 1817, shortly after the Napoleonic Wars, Napoleon had swept over much of Germany, then pushed back. In 1817, there was a great celebration at the Wartburg, Luther's castle where he'd translated the scriptures, but aimed at German national unity. And amidst a lot of feasting and beer drinking and salutes to the glories of the German future, Luther stood as a progenitor, not so much of the gospel, but a progenitor of Deutschtum, of Germanness. In the United States, there weren't at that time too many German immigrants, but there were American Protestants who used the occasion to rail on Catholics and then Catholics to responding, but to railing on Protestants. In 1917, Germany's opponents in the First World War criticized Luther as being one of the originators of what had turned out to be, in their eyes, the oppressive, aggressive, tyrannical rule of the Kaiser. In 1967, interestingly enough, East Germans at the 450th anniversary, East Germans tried to generate enthusiasm for the Reformation focused on Thomas Munzer, one of the leaders of the peasant revolt, as a person who was showing how the proletariat emerged out of the Reformation. Nobody in the world paid attention. The East Germans then switched gears, and in 1983 they said, well, if nobody wants to come to East Germany to spend their tourist dollars on Thomas Munzer, maybe they'll do it on this monk, Martin Luther. The German government sponsored a half-hearted promotional celebration of Martin Luther's birthday, and people from all over the world flooded into Wittenberg and related places, and the East Germans finally woke up that they had a saleable commodity on their hands. And now, we were in Wittenberg a summer ago, and I've talked to people who've been there more recently. I think the capitalists have taken a lesson from the communists. And if you want to buy anything Martin Luther related this year, go to Leipzig, travel down to Wittenberg, go even to Berlin, the major centers, and you can spend a lot of money on Luther memorabilia. A properly Protestant, and indeed Christian celebration, commemoration of the Reformation, however, will be responsible, will be humble, and will be accurate. If there is to come to the present, guidance from the past, it'll be in that way and not in some of these flamboyant and not particularly productive ways of the past. However, today, it's important to recognize that things are very different from the way they were in 1517. And the first difference to note is that the Christian world has become post-Christian. This map that you have presented to you comes courtesy of the World Christian Database maintained at Gordon Seminary, in Gordon Conwell Seminary in Massachusetts. And you can see from it that the places in the world that are witnessing dramatic Christian expansion are not the places in the world that were active in the Reformation. Today, there are more active Lutherans in Africa than in Europe and the United States combined. There are more active Lutherans in Tanzania than there are in the United States. And then from the Reformed and Presbyterian side of things, there are more Presbyterians in each of the Presbyterian Church of Ghana, the Presbyterian Church of Brazil, and the Uniting Reformed Church in Southern Africa, more active members in each of these denominations than in the EPC, the PCA, the RCA, and the CRC combined. And there are more active Presbyterians in Korea than Presbyterians of all kinds in the United States and Canada. So, for an ever-growing number of the world's Christians, the struggles of the Reformation have never been exactly their struggles. Of course, there's continuing interest in the Protestant world and in the broader Christian world of the Reformation, but it can't be the same as for the churches of Europe and North America that are, in some sense, directly descended from the churches of the Reformation. For churches of any kind throughout the world, reform remains critical, but for the churches in the West and all over, the crucial tasks now include outreach to those with no experience of Christianity at all, and the challenge of living as partial aliens in cultures that are not defined by Christian values. Martin Luther, John Calvin, Thomas Cranmer, Menno Simons all wanted to reform what they thought was a Christian world gone bad. Believers in the world today are not committed, not given the task of reforming what has gone bad, but often planting what has not existed. Another way of saying, talking about the changes is to realize that the Western world has moved beyond Christendom. And if you put that a different way, secularism prevails in Europe and North America. Religion no longer provides the general frame for all of life as it did in the Middle Ages. Again, Luther, Calvin, Zwingli, other Protestant reformers wanted to correct the mistakes that had crept into the Christian view of the world. That's a very different challenge than what faces Christian believers today. Human rights, as an example, began as a notion in the Catholic Middle Ages. Human rights was expanded, particularly with Reformed contributions in the 16th, 17th, and 18th century. But today, in many places in the world, human rights are being promoted without consideration of the Imago Dei, the image of God that was so important for all Christian groups earlier when they talked about human rights. Of course, there are lingering bits of Christendom, European state churches, magnificent places to enter, but also often places where your footsteps echo because no one is there. Much art and music retains the beneficial impact of the Christian culture. In the United States, we have varieties of civil religion that try to carry on in an informal way the links between society and Christian faith. But this is really a very different world. Christian assumptions are gone in the general culture, are largely gone about marriage, family, education, work, consumption, the goals of politics, the definition of what a good life is. It's not as though you, as leaders of Christian churches, face erroneous Christian views or views that have grown corrupt out of a Christian past, but views that have no reference at all to the Christian faith. Interesting datum with respect to Martin Luther. He was concerned about the economic sinfulness in his day, and as a person who felt that the scriptures were quite clear, Luther held that lending out money at interest was sinful. Usury, he took the passages from the Pentateuch as still prevailing in the Christian world, and he thought that you were violating God's law when you lent money at interest. John Calvin, some of you will know, made a very cautious move and said, well, maybe widows who have an estate can lend out money at a very low rate of interest for just a little bit. They were working in a world where the expectations of what it meant to be Christian economically have changed dramatically from what we experience today. A third manner in which the world has changed today is that Catholic and Protestant divisions are not what they once were. At least since the Second Vatican Council in the 1960s, many Catholics in many parts of the world have been learning from evangelicals about the personal experience of faith, the priesthood of all believers, and the virtues of lay study of the scriptures. Evangelicals, and again in many parts of the world and in many Christian communities, have been learning from Catholics about the importance of life at all stages of human development, about holistic ministry, about liturgy and philosophy. Of course, there are still serious differences between the Catholic tradition and Protestant traditions, especially over the role of the church itself in the process of salvation. But these differences are far from what they were in the early 16th century. Some of you will know that there was a conference in 1541 at the South German city of Regensburg where Catholic and Protestant leaders got together. They sat down and they worked hard on coming up with a common formula for justification by faith. And they did it. 1541, Martin Luther was not there. He read it and he was kind of grumpy. He said, well, this doesn't stand for much. But it really was quite remarkable. Then the conference moved to considering what role did the church's officers have in the process of bringing justification, and the conference collapsed. 1541, there is virtual silence, Catholics learning from Protestants, Protestants learning from Catholics, until the lifetime of many of you here today. So our situation is much unlike 1517, where today the world's most widely recognized proclaimers of the Christian faith are Catholic figures, like the ones on the screen. The first formal promulgation of the current pope was an apostolic letter entitled Evangelii Gaudium, which included these words: a renewal of preaching can offer believers as well as the lukewarm and the non-practicing new joy in the faith and fruitfulness in the work of evangelization. The heart of its message will always be the same. The God who revealed his immense love in the crucified and risen Christ, God constantly renews his faithful ones, whatever their age. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. Christ is the eternal gospel. He is the same yesterday and today and forever. Yet his riches and beauty are inexhaustible. He is forever young and a constant source of newness. The church never fails to be amazed at the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. This, friends, is the Pope. You will know that Pope Francis went to Sweden and met with the leaders of the Lutheran World Federation and made a statement about justification by faith that some Protestant leaders in Europe thought was very Protestant. Other Protestant leaders said, no, no, this is still the old Catholicism in just a new dress. And so there was a little bit of controversy about what he meant. But the fact that there was controversy over whether or not the Pope was affirming something like a Reformation doctrine of justification by faith, friends, that is something in our age that did not exist not too many years ago. The primary challenge today, it seems to me, is not to escape from the corruptions and errors of Rome, but to maximize areas of common Christian agreement in belief and practice. But recognizing these changes, how to make the most of commemorating the Reformation in 2017? Many possibilities. I'd like at this stage to offer for rental Clinton Schaefer, who's a German professor at Wheaton College, who is a member of Emmanuel Presbyterian, who does just a bang-up imitation of Dr. Martin Luther with gowns and German accent and the whole, but I think he's a family man and he won't want to travel widely to give his impersonation of Martin Luther. Study courses that churches put on with some of the raft of just an incredible array of new books on Luther and the Reformation, or some of the older ones. Roland Baton's Here I Stand, A Life of Martin Luther still reads very well, still tremendously grounded in the sources of Luther's life. Study of these kind of books would be a wonderful thing for selected members of the congregation. My suggestion is today is to try to isolate five matters, five concerns, where it's possible to recognize that what mattered for Martin Luther in 1517 is still what matters today. And the first of these is to realize that context matters. Sorry? I'm like Martin Luther. I never, he never used PowerPoint, and I don't do it too often myself. Luther's proclamation of the gospel shook Europe because he understood where he was and who he was. Intellectually, it was an era of new learning. The forces of what we now call the Renaissance had emphasized return to sources, ad fontes, to the fountain of wisdom. And this was a movement that Luther's concern for the Greek and Hebrew of the scriptures could latch onto and lend his own study of the Bible in the original language extra clout, extra power, extra force. 16th century was an economic era with new powers rising. We have new economic powers rising in our world. How will Christians understand these and the effects that they have on daily life? Politically, there was wrangling, as we've seen already today, between the ways in which church and state unite. Our age is different. We wrangle about how church and state should be separated. What's the appropriate way for the institutions of the state, the institutions of the church, to do their task without confusion, without stepping on the toes of the other side? Religiously, in Luther's day, the great problem was that the church, at least in many of its members, many of its leaders, was not responding effectively to the most pressing questions that people were raising. In our day, that's still the case, but we have all kinds of churches responding to all kinds of problems in a much more pluralistic environment. Martin Luther probably might have been a few very casual contacts with Jews. Martin Luther probably never met someone who wasn't baptized as a Christian. In most of your communities, there will be numbers of people who are not only not Christian, but come from other traditions, sometimes purely secular, but sometimes given the melting pot the United States is from Hindu and Muslim and other religious backgrounds. The personal challenges for Martin Luther and many of his contemporaries was his sense of alienation from a God whose presence was too close. In our day, that still exists for many people, but for many others, the difficulty is not feeling a God who is too close, but not feeling God at all. And the churches have the responsibility to understand in this context how the gospel is to be presented with the force that it deserves. The lesson today is not that gospel proclamation and biblical truth need to conform to the spirit of the age. It's that the gospel message must speak to the spirit of the age. In order to speak to the spirit of the age, we must understand something about the spirit of the age. We must, in some sense, participate in it, even while the gospel message is reforming us in that age. Just as in the 16th century, the leading Protestants spoke the gospel to the spirit of the age in the 16th century. So context matters, but then also, so also does daily life. Clarifying the gospel message and returning to the scripture as final authority had real consequences for daily life in Martin Luther's era. His message exerted a great impact because it made a difference in how people lived their lives day to day. Yes, the teaching of justification by grace through faith, the reliance upon Scripture as the final authority were momentous changes. But for many, many people, ideals about marriage, ideals about the reliability, the respect of daily vocations became more important. In the medieval church, marriage had certainly been accepted. It was a sacrament. But still there was a sense that the celibate monastic life was a better, a purer, a quicker way to God. Luther and the other Protestants said, no, this is a mistake. Marriage is honorable. It's not merely a device to chain in lust, though it is that. Marriage is something that can bring fulfillment. Marriage is something that can bring dignity. Marriage is something as a naturally created gift of God should be open to all people, even those who want to be most serious about the Christian life. Lay vocations, as given by God, were also an innovation that changed daily life, that gave respect to those who labored in the disciplines, labored in the fields that had respect, but labored also amongst people whose work had no and little respect. In the political life, the introduction of themes about the priesthood of all believers spilled over so that what we would probably call today a democratic element entered into political life because of the empowerment of the Christian life. So in the 16th century, the Reformation was, of course, a dramatic theological movement. But for most people, most of the time, it was also a movement that altered the shape of their daily lives. Today, churches can face a danger, I think, when trying to specify in great detail the day-to-day implications of the Christian life, but it's an equal danger when the Christian faith is presented as something that has no implications for daily life. If it is something carried into its own sphere that makes us feel good and proper and accepted to God outside of daily life, then the Christian faith is being truncated. Concern for family life is actually very interesting to have the sermon that you heard earlier today emphasize generation to generation is a family activity. My own sense is that Christian churches that have an impact on families today will have the greatest impact in our societies. For much of the rest of the world in which we live, economics, labor, politics, world conditions, my own sense is the important thing is not specific instruction from the churches. The churches are not expert in these things, but an awareness that Christian faith, by its very nature, must affect everything. This is a story that I like to tell when I'm speaking to ministers, and it has to do with Martin Luther's advice that he gave to parents concerning the education of their children. He said, if you have two or three kids, two or three boys, it was in that era, if you have two or three boys and you're trying to help them figure out what they should do in life, steer the one with the least intellectual ability toward the priesthood, toward the pastorate. Pastors have the word of God. Pastors have the word of God to show them what they should teach, how they should live. But if you've got a son who's really smart, who really knows how to maneuver in the world, get that person, help that person be a lawyer or a magistrate, because there you do not have the word of God. You need to rely on your own wisdom to use the talents and abilities that God has given. Martin Luther could speak with his tongue in both sides of his mouth sometimes, and I think he was joking somewhat there, but his point was that daily life is the arena of God's concern, the creator and the one who will bring to culmination the creation that he has made needs people bringing Christian sensibilities into the task of every day. And then, for the next part, I'm just going to ask you to remember what you heard during the sermon, because without collusion, it is very obvious to me as a historian that in the Reformation, singing mattered tremendously. It's not often understood how important congregational song factored into the spread of Protestantism. And the congregational song that we know in a few remaining instances, like A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, was instruction, was biblical, was emotional, and was long-lived. It stuck in people's minds. Luther's own hymn composition included 37 different hymns. Many of them were simple, or not so simple, teaching tools. Before the 5 years had passed from his appearance before Charles V at the Diet of Worms, he had set to music the Ten Commandments, the Apostles' Creed, and then other scripture and liturgical matters that he hoped heads of households would use in singing the faith with their households, and that then could be used in the congregation together. It would be jarring for some of your churches to go back and sing some of the hymns of Martin Luther, but it could be a good historical occasion. And it might be even interesting if you could recruit some of your expert music people to write contemporary music or music that would fit with the ancient lyrics of the 16th century, because those lyrics so completely embodied the scripture message of salvation by grace through faith, put into memorable and easily repeatable format. So here's an example from Luther's great hymn, Aus tiefer Not schrei ich zu dir, Psalm 30, from depths of woe, I raise to thee the voice of lamentation. Lord, turn a gracious ear to me and hear my supplication. If thou iniquities dost mark, our secret sins and misdeeds dark, oh, who could stand before thee? Though great our sins and sore our woes, his grace much more aboundeth. His helping love no limit knows, our utmost need it soundeth. Our shepherd good and true is he, who will at last his Israel free from all their sin and sorrow. Been really interesting books published in the last 20 and 25 years that make the argument that it was Lutheran hymnody more than any other single factor that preserved Lutheranism through the difficult days at the end of the 16th century, with its constant opposition from the emperor, constant division amongst the leaders of German ducal states. The hymnody united hearts, instructed minds, and kept congregations going. It was the same in the Reformed world, where with a slightly different attitude toward what was appropriate from the scriptures. As many of you know, the Reformed tradition was a psalm singing or a psalm revising and singing tradition. But it was the same way that out of Geneva, the versification of the psalms became not just a curiosity. The versification of the psalms became, as it were, the lifeblood, the inspiration, the continuity for Reformed churches. I greet thee who my sure redeemer art, my only trust and savior of my heart, who pain didst undergo for my poor sake. I pray thee from our hearts all cares to take. Thou art the King of mercy and of grace. Hymnody from Protestants was so effective that there was a renovation in the Catholic Church to respond. Catholics were not going to do a lot of congregational singing because that was undercutting too much the authority of the bishops. Catholics were not going to do a lot of singing in the vernacular, where all the great hymns of the Reformation were in vernacular languages, but Catholics would rethink what was being done with their music. And so we have the great mass works of Palestrina and other Catholic composers in the second half of the 16th century and the 17th century who tried to put into Catholic Reform musical shape what the Catholics considered the essentials of the Christian faith. And that did for their population something of what Protestant hymnody did for Protestants. I'm just going to repeat, I think, what you heard earlier today. Why is singing so important? It has a sacramental type quality because it involves bodily activity, driving home gospel truths with great emotional force. And when the hymns are composed carefully, when the hymns are expert paraphrases of scripture or expert thinking about the basis of scripture, we have something that remains very important in the churches. faithfulness matters. It's one of the most interesting and in some ways poignant task of a historian to track the lives of people who passed from the scene when they thought that what they were after was not going to succeed. The whole history of Christianity is littered with people who died defeated to all earthly appearances, but who now, later, in historical insight, are seen as paved the way for what was genuine, true, helpful, and effective. We remember many of the early great Protestant leaders as setting a path that later Protestant churches followed fruitfully and helpfully. We do not always remember that those who set the path never got to go on them themselves. Jan Hus, not a 16th century figure, but the reformer of Bohemia, who innovated in the late 14th century and early 15th century by preaching in Czech, in Prague, who was a student of the scriptures, who raised that question that Andreas Bodenstein from Karlstadt would raise: where in the Bible does it say the lay people are not supposed to have the wine as well as the bread in communion? Let's study this. They did. Hus was a scholar, so he didn't just rush off and do this, but he studied it, and he concluded the lay people should have the cup. And so he led a movement that was called the Utraquist, both kinds. And this irritated, concerned, led to retribution from the church. At the Great Council of Constance in the early 15th century, Hus was issued a safe conduct to come and to plead his own cause. He came, his cause was discussed. He presented what he thought about the importance of preaching from the scriptures in the vernacular, what he had said about the Lord's Supper. The council ruled against him, and ruled also that because he was a heretic, they did not have to abide by their word that was given of a safe conduct. And so Hus goes to the flames. When Martin Luther was coming to Worms in 1521 in a procession, he knew he was Hus on the way to Constance. And only the intervention of his prince, the elector Frederick the Wise, kept Luther in 1521 from being what Hus had been in 1415. Felix Mons was one of the early Anabaptists who had learned the scriptures from Ulrich Zwingli in Zurich and was drawn to the message of free grace, the gospel message, but then who, in an irritating way that some of your best students do, said, "Dr. Ulrich, tell me in the Bible about the baptism of infants. Tell me in the Bible about where the scripture tells the instruments of state and the instruments of church to be interlocked together. Tell me in the Bible where it says that the followers of Jesus are supposed to beat other people over the head if they don't follow the gospel that the leaders say." And Zwingli actually had a pretty good response on infant baptism. I've got to say that, I'm a Presbyterian. And he responded by appealing to the covenants of the Old Testament and the gospel fulfillment of the covenants of the New Testament. But he really didn't have a very good response on the interlocking of a coercive church and a coercive state. He really didn't have a good response on many of the other charges that the people who were soon going to be called Anabaptists, because they were baptizing themselves again, made on the basis of what they thought Zwingli had taught in the scriptures. Felix Mons was one of the early Anabaptists. He was judged to be a heretic by Protestant Zurich, 1527, and his mode of execution was to be drowned in Lake Zurich as a statement to those who would question the Zurich Town Council's conclusions about how people should be baptized. Felix Mons died not realizing that the message of separation of coercive powers would actually become important for much of the Christian world. In fact, for all of the Christian world, virtually almost all of the Christian world to this day. He died not knowing what would come thereafter. Anne Askew was one of the many women of the early 16th century who heard and then read for themselves the gospel message that was coming out of Germany, that eventually came from Switzerland, eventually in England was developed by leaders of the English church like Thomas Bilney, who we talked about in the earlier hour. She was called before magistrates in the early 1530s. The magistrates demanded that she abandon her heretical views. She had spoken out against the Mass and said that one insight from the Word of God was worth many, many Masses. And she was arraigned. She was importuned to repent of her heresy. She maintained her faithfulness. She was publicly burned at the stake and memorialized in Fox's Book of Martyrs. Her manner of death was dramatic. As a concession to her being a female, there was a bag of gunpowder hung over her head so that when the flames ignited the gunpowder, it ended her life. Such was mercy in the 16th century. More famous is the life of William Tyndale. All of our English language scriptures, and it doesn't matter what your favorite variety is, all of them come from William Tyndale. Tyndale's New Testament in the 1525 and 1526, and then the work that he did on much of the Old Testament before he was executed in the 1530s, was the basis for the Geneva Bible, was the basis even more for the King James Bible, and remains the basis for the New International Version, today's, and all of the versions that we have. Tyndale died not knowing that there would be an English language Bible revolution that he promoted. He had to flee from England after he had begun work on the translation. He was actually acquainted in a friendly way with the Bishop of London, whom he thought might be amenable to the suggestion that English people should have the Bible in English for themselves. England was an outlier in the 15th and 16th century because the authorities had clamped down on vernacular language Bibles. It's a very interesting thing to read about the history of the Bible on the continent when there are many, many translations into German, French, and some of the other European languages that were alive in the early 16th century. I was taught back in the dawn of time that the Reformation took place because Protestants discovered the Bible. It's much more accurate to say that Protestantism occurred when people discovered a new angle or approach or interpretation of the Bible. That Europe was awash in vernacular language Bibles, but not England, because the vernacular language translations associated with Wycliffe had been associated with a socially disruptive group, the Lollards, who had led to some uprisings in the early 15th century, after which vernacular language Bibles were restricted. So in the early 16th century, Tyndale was only trying to bring up to date in England what had gone on in other parts of the world. And as we know, he was exiled. He kept working on the scriptures. He wrote, like the Apostle Paul, to his friends when he was in prison in Antwerp, "Please bring the cloaks and my manuscripts," so he'd keep working. But when he was executed, he did not know that you and you and you and I would today be able to read the Bible in English in many translations. He died praying, as you can see, if you can see the details, "Lord, open the King of England's eyes." Henry VIII's eyes probably didn't open too much, but his work went on. Faithfulness mattered. Thomas Cranmer, the great story, which I won't go into, you know it. He was the Archbishop of Canterbury under Henry VIII. He tried to promote Protestant views under Henry's son, Edward VI. When Edward died and Edward was succeeded by another child of Henry, Mary Tudor, Catholic, the pushback came against Protestants, and Cranmer was executed, not knowing that the Church of England, the Book of Common Prayer, the 39 Articles, would spread throughout the world as a banner of gospel proclamation in this particular English way. And then It's also crucial to note that in the 16th and 17th century, there were Catholics who died not knowing that their reforming efforts would lead to the worldwide dissemination of Catholic Christianity and in some ways prepare the way for the worldwide dissemination of Protestant Christianity. Many of you will know the book by Shishaku Endo, Silence, about the Jesuit mission in Japan, where there was a significant turn to Catholic Christianity at the end of the 16th century, start of the 17th century, several hundred thousand Japanese converts, shut down by a brutal regime change that put the pressure on the Catholic population. That novel, recent movie of that book, is a really moving display of the faithfulness of not Protestant Christians, but Catholic Christians, to what they considered the highest standards of Christ-honoring life. The point to be made today is that God asks us in churches to be faithful. Whether or not what you do in your church sees immediate results, sees results in the long term, is obviously, these are important matters. But they're not your concern. Your concern is to do what God asks you to do faithfully. And in that ideal of faithfulness, I think it's hard to find a better venue of examples than the 16th century emergence of Protestantism, and then we could also say Catholic Reform as well. But finally, and I'm a Protestant who was talking about the history of Protestantism. I'm a person who thinks Luther made an awful lot of mistakes, but got the big thing right. The lesson for Protestant churches today, for Christian churches today, in looking back 500 years, is that in the welter of really important changes, really important developments that took place in the 16th century, the one central development of supreme importance is the gospel. Especially the message of Martin Luther that focuses on the suffering of Christ as the triumph over sin, death, and the devil. This message is what the Reformation deserves to be remembered for most. Yes, there were other things, some of them very good, some of them not so good. But when the Reformation is remembered for anything but the gospel proclamation that was at its heart, it's a misunderstanding of the Reformation. According to Martin Luther, the cross was the sun that gives light to everything else. And the sun is the mercy of God in Christ. Luther's challenge across the centuries is to take seriously the words of Scripture themselves. It's when Barnabas and Paul told the Christians in Antioch, we must go through many hardships, tribulations, to enter the kingdom of God. Luther's appeal to us today, and the appeal of most of the Protestant reformers, is to see God as he really is, to see life as it really is, and to see ourselves as we really are. And to seeing all of these things is to know the cross of Christ. The testimony of Martin Luther was a testimony of the Apostle Paul in his letter to the Philippians. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his suffering, becoming like him in death, and so somehow to attain the resurrection from the dead. Martin Luther deserves to be remembered for many memorable statements. There are many of Martin Luther's statements that he deserves to be completely forgotten. But there are many that he deserves to be remembered for. We've talked about a couple of these today. My conscience is captive to the word of God. There was a wonderful opening to his treatise from also in 1520 on the freedom of a Christian. The Christian is the most free Lord of all and subject to none. The Christian is the most dutiful servant of all, subject to everyone. Luther was trying to say that salvation is free. Good works do not bring salvation, but the work of God in people who have been redeemed is to do good works. Luther's memorably promoted the crucial idea of the priesthood of all believers. That idea can be taken to mean that the believer has the right, the privileges, the responsibility of standing before God without mediation of human instrumentality, the mediation only of Christ. And that was part of Luther's message. But when he talked about the priesthood of all believers, he meant the priesthood of everyone empowered to act as Christ in the community, in the church. The priesthood of all believers was a statement about what believers can do for others as much as it was a statement about what God can do for believers. The most widely publicized and distributed work of Martin Luther was his small catechism. It reads wonderfully. In my own estimation, it and the Heidelberg Catechism are the two great statements of Christian faith that come out of the 16th century from the Protestant tradition. His explanation of how Christ died freely for sinners is part of his exposition of the Apostles' Creed. And if you haven't read Luther's small catechism recently, you should take it up. But of all of Luther's statements, the very last words which he wrote sum up perhaps his vision of God the best. They are words that deserve to be repeated this 500th anniversary year as much or more than his more famous speeches. He wrote a brief treatise in Latin, his last work, and then he lapsed into German. Wir sind Bettler, das ist wahr. We are beggars, that's the truth. Luther also knew, however, that God is God, who in the cross of Christ heard the beggar's cry. Let me close my part here before we get to the really interesting thing, to see what you have to say, with the prayer from the Episcopal Church that is given on the fast of Martin Luther. Let us pray. O God, our refuge and our strength, you raised up your servant Martin Luther to reform and renew your church in the light of your word. Defend and purify the church in our own day, and grant that, through faith, we may boldly proclaim the riches of your grace, which you have made known in Jesus Christ our Savior, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Noll. It was a delight to have him here for these lectures. Now, it's your turn to ask questions. Ma'am, just make a recommendation that at the conclusion of whatever it is you say, there is a question mark. Anyone?
Dr. Noll, you wrote in The Scandal of the Evangelical Mind that revivalism was a blessing and a cursing. How is that connected to some of the things with respect to sola scriptura feeding into that? Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think so how is the revivalism has been characteristic of American church life. How might it be related to sola scriptura and then the issue of blessing and problems in the Reformation? The revival tradition in the United States and next to the Western world and now the world as a whole has a tremendous contribution to what it does in broadcasting the message that people need a savior. And at its best, and the revivalists have, of course, different theologies and come from different parts of the theological spectrum, but revivalism that's effective will be always concentrating on God's solution to human problems. And you don't have to be a Protestant, just a Christian to realize that that's what the Bible is there for. And if we say sola scriptura, the Bible and nothing else, we're probably amiss, but we say sola scriptura, what's the basic message of the Bible? Humans need God in Christ. And that revivalists have effectively broadcast that message. The difficulties have come I think, when the focus on the broadcasting of that message overwhelms everything else. Humans need Christ to be redeemed. Yes. But humans also need Christ to know how to raise their children. Humans need Christ to know how to operate in the world of business. Humans need Christ in order to develop worship that is God-honoring and will lead generations to follow, to come after. And so the Christian message can always be made pointal, but if it's left as a point, then there are problems. The Christian message that has a point leads on to a vast awareness of life to be led, thoughts to be had, generations to be effective. So I want to say two cheers for revivalism, but not three, because there always needs to be a life to live after a life comes alive.
Way back. Dr. Noll, mine is not going to be a theological question. It's going to be fairly simple. How do we get copies of your notes?
Well, I believe this is the internet age where you just probably have to send an email.
Appreciate your talk today, Dr. Noll. Broad questions, and you hit on some of this in your first talk, but do you feel like the Reformation was inevitable? And I'm thinking economic and cultural and political changes, that headwinds that were behind Luther. Was it inevitable that if Luther didn't happen, the next guy would have?
Yeah.
So was the Reformation inevitable? And what I'm even more intrigued by, do you feel like there are things that are inevitable, or at least you personally feel are likely in the next few years of church life today, when you look at the culture and compare the two?
It's a real interesting question. What has it do really about the contingency of what actually happened? To what extent was there a drift of history that was going to happen, whatever? I actually think that there would have been reform in Western Christendom, because as some of the expanding studies on what's now being called actually the Reformation's era are pointing out, is there are a lot of voices in the 15th century before Martin Luther that in part sound like Martin Luther. So I mentioned Johannes von Staupitz today. He brought his Augustinian theology and said, don't be so nervous about the philosophy coming from nominalism. And in particular, don't worry so much about God's arbitrary power. See the Christian message principally as God's work in Christ. There were other people, there are other voices saying that. Justification by faith. A man with an interesting name of Wessel von Gonsfort in the 15th century who had a doctrine of justification very, very similar to Martin Luther. Luther, when he finally read Gonsfort in the 1520, said, goodness sakes, he's saying what I'm saying. There were all sorts of people who were complaining about the corruptions in the church, the problems of the papacy, the problems of bishops selling, buying their office. Erasmus, who became Luther's foe, wrote a lot on how the church needed to get its act in order. So all these things were happening. Secular rulers were becoming increasingly upset with the overreaching power of the Pope. My own sense is that some kind of systematic reform would have been inevitable. Would there have been the sharp focus on justification by faith, which to me is mostly positive? Would there have been the sharp focus on sola scriptura, meaning the Bible is fundamental, which has had some problems, but positive too, without Martin Luther? I don't think so. I mean, I think the reform would have been more evolutionary. The reform would have left the Catholic Church as it had been, where there were many, many varieties. It's only really the Council of Trent, sort of a response to Protestantism, that you get defined Catholic doctrine. There's no anathemas against believing in justification by faith until the 1550s. So it does make a difference. The present, you never want to ask a historian about predicting the future. But I'll do it anyways. My own sense, going back to the very first map that we saw, is that if you really want your grandkids, if you really want those people who are just being born or in their 10 years old today, to have a full grasp on the most important theology when they're adults, when they're your age, have them learn Chinese, Korean, Portuguese, Swahili. Because these dynamic regions of church ferment and church expansion, I don't want to use the word inevitable, but I'm tempted, will almost inevitably lead to serious thinking about the experience of Christian faith. And those are the parts of the world where that the dynamism of Christian faith is present today.
Anyone else?
Thank you, Dr. Noll. Could you say a word about the Protestant and Catholic distinction between the church and Israel in the 16th century?
The church?
And Israel.
I'm not an expert on the question of the church and Israel in the 16th century. My understanding is that there would not have been a whole lot of difference between the major Protestant leaders and the careful Catholic thinkers who would have all considered Jews in general as in some way in general guilty of rejecting Christ and therefore guilty of the most serious possible penalty. It's interesting that it's not until you get Protestant regimes that are really self-consciously grateful for the recovery of Hebrew and a better understanding of the Old Testament that you get a little bit more toleration for the Jews. When I was in school, 1492 was an important date for Columbus. The really important thing that happened in 1492 was the last destruction of the Moorish town, the kingdom Granada in Spain, the union of Castile and Aragon, Ferdinand and Isabella, and the expulsion of Jews and Moors. Luther's anti-Jewish tracts are really not unusual. In the 17th century, during the Cromwellian years in England, Cromwell relaxes prohibitions against the Jews because he realizes that the Old Testament heritage of the Christian faith is so important. And so you begin to get some of the modern discussion that goes right up to the present on where do Jews fit into Christian conceptions. But I think in the 16th century, it was a very rare Catholic or Protestant who would have had anything positive to say about the Jewish contribution to the modern Christian faith.
One last question here.
Dr. Noll, some traditions have used sola scriptura as a justification for rejecting confessional statements and catechisms and the like. So two-part question. How do you account for the explosion of confessional statements and catechisms right. during the 16th right. and 17th century in light of the return to sola scriptura? And how can we communicate now yeah. the importance of these yeah. confessional statements?
Well, don't get me started on sola scriptura. Let's see. We'll be out of here by 1:15, I promise. I want to make a categorical statement, and probably there'll be exception. Nobody who appealed to the Bible alone or sola scriptura in the 16th century meant the Bible without other authorities. Sola scriptura was a wonderful hammer of critique. When somebody was doing something that you didn't think was right, you could appeal to the Bible as the authority to show the problem with whatever it is you didn't like. So Martin Luther appealed to the scriptures to show that indulgences had either gotten completely out of hand or were just wrong to start with. Felix Mons would appeal to scripture when he thought Zwingli's linking together coercive state and coercive church was wrong. But as soon as the turn was toward constituting Christian life, reforming Christian life, then all groups relied on some extra authorities, not as the ultimate, and all would have said, like the Westminster Confession, we have a prime standard, and the other things are amendable by it. And a little history helps. I have to say that as a defense of my own profession. So to realize that sola scriptura was a critique, but not a platform for going forward helps. And I think the realization that the Bible is not the story. The main story in the Bible is entirely clear to everyone who has even minimal intelligence. Beyond the main story of the Bible, it's tricky. How do the expressions of the Psalms align with the letters of St. Paul? That's a good question. How do the variations in what are seen in the Gospels, in the chronology of the life of Jesus, how should they affect how we consider the Gospels? These are not easy questions. The profusion of catechisms like Luther's small catechism, the Augsburg Confession, the Heidelberg Catechism, eventually the Westminster Confession, came, I think, from the recognition that although there had been actually a great deal of Bible-oriented reform and efforts at newer life in the 15th century, and that continued in some ways in the Catholic Church, it was not systematized and made useful for Christian communities that wanted to be reformed. And so then you got just an amazing development of these confessions, mostly effective in individual localities. So it's the rare one like Luther's small catechism. And you know the story of how the small catechism gets started. There's visitations in Saxony, and the people come back and say, these people are ignorant. There are priests who told us, the Ten Commandments. Is that a new book that I should be reading? The Apostles' Creed. Now, I've heard of that somewhere. And Luther, he says, somebody write something simple. And he himself did placards. What's the Ten Commandments? And nobody else did it. So they flung these things together, and there's the Luther's small catechism. Heidelberg Catechism begins in Heidelberg, and then it's used elsewhere. Because sola scriptura meant, in practice, a reliance upon Scripture for clarifying the main story of God's grace to sinners, but it did not mean getting rid of everything else.